Well, I want to tell you, a little over four years ago, was the first time I ever heard Wendell McGinnis read from that little notebook he carries around. And when I first heard him, I said, "Wendell, one of these days, me or the Lord One's going to ask you to read to everybody from that little notebook." Then a couple of weeks ago, Wendell came to me and he said, "Hey, man, you know how Wendell does. I think I'm ready to say something. So you are here on a special day because I'm not going to say anything. Wendell's going to be in the pulpit this morning, and so I may be out of a job. But Wendell, come on, man, and lay on us what God laid on you." Surprise. That's what I meant to say. Because the sermon title, I don't know if you noticed, it says "The Last One You'd Expect." Wendell, that's not a coincidence. I mean, I don't believe in coincidences, but that's something that was written down several months ago. So, come on, Wendell.
First of all, that last part about worrying about his job, no worries. How's everyone this morning? Good to be here, ain't it? Let me sort of get, I'm one of these that's not too organized, but I'm going to try to get organized here before I begin. You know, it's a funny thing that I came back when I first said something to Chris about sharing this morning. And I think it was a couple of days later, and I said, "If you looked at the title of the sermon," and it's like he just read, of course, it was 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 1 through 13, "The Last One You'd Expect." And we had a chuckle, and Chris used the word, "That's mighty serendipitous, isn't it?" I thought about that word serendipitous. I don't know where it came from, but I just about bet that it is definitely born out of the South. And this has nothing to do with it, but the sermon or anything, but I like that word. And I can almost picture whatever years ago it was, and it had to be a woman that gave it this name, serendipitous. I can see her sitting under a live oak tree with the boughs nearly touching the ground, moss hanging in the trees, sitting in a comfortable white Adirondack chair with maybe even a mint julep by her side, and a little notebook or tablet or whatever, and come across that word serendipitous. I like it. And I'll tell you something else. Chris said he don't believe in coincidences. But now there's one thing that we will agree on. The Spirit of Christ can be mighty serendipitous at times. Can he? But I'd like to, first of all, before I ever even speak any words that I've written down, I'd like to thank this church for giving me the opportunity, and for Chris for the opportunity. But most of all, I'd like to thank Jesus Christ and His Spirit for the opportunity. I'll say this, and I'll probably say it again. If I do, forgive me. The words I'm going to read aren't mine. They're really not. All I've done is write them down. Now, some might say, "You know, that's strange," but it is true. But before we read some scripture and I'll read these words that I've written down, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father God, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Lord, the one that you brought into this world and left it for each and every one of us to be a part of our lives, live with us, and guide us along this life's hard journey. And yes, Lord, it is hard at times, but who am I telling? Lord, I just pray for your spirit this morning. I pray for open hearts and open ears, all of us, everyone in this room that can hear me. Lord, that's my prayer this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen. Well, I've got, I'm not one of these as good that trying to remember things. I have to write everything that I'm led to write it down on in either a little book like this or a notebook or whatever. But I've got some words written down in here. But the Spirit of Christ led me to say this before I ever read these words, to validate for myself and maybe for all of y'all sitting out here what reading scripture from this book right here really means, what it means to me. Before I read these words the Spirit has given me that I've written down, I would like to say something about reading and studying the Scriptures. For I do believe it matters, at least ways it does for me, and maybe for all of you. Also, I put much thought and prayer in a way to say this. I know no other way than to say it this way. I'm going to hold this up and say, can't we say that this book is a living and breathing part of our lives? That's made possible by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, by Him and the Holy Spirit He's given us. These words aren't just old ink on old paper that never move us, or show us things we've never seen before, or fail to see. For the Spirit of Christ Jesus brings all these words to life. They are living and breathing, and I believe always nudging, urging, and leading us to look closer. Now I know, and you know, our God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This is true. His love for us will never change. But my question to you is, do the words from Scripture always stay the same? We all agreed earlier, this book is living and breathing. It's a part of us. It's a gift from God. For someone here today, might be holding right now one of those Bibles that I don't know when they published it, but it's even got the name on the front of it, the Living Bible. Lastly, I will say all this to make this point. Scripture grows and changes when we grow and change. I could be wrong. If I am, forgive me. But how on earth can it be, if the Spirit of Christ Jesus is alive today with us, just as He was with His disciples when He brought Him into this world to live freely among us, how can it be then this Spirit says to all of us, stop looking, stop searching, for the words are written. There's nothing more. For me, and I hope you also, I can't accept that. We like to use the phrase, coming to the light. That light being a closer walk with our Savior and a better understanding of our Savior, and probably the hardest of all, what Jesus meant when He said the words He said. I've said all this to say this. Sometimes the light of Jesus and the Spirit, the light of the world, are even hidden from us. If everything we read from the scriptures and all we see are old words on old paper and always seeing them the same way, I will leave this world believing the light of Christ and the Spirit sometimes lies beneath and behind the words of Scripture, shining ever so brightly and alive, just waiting to be found. Now, someone smarter and someone with way more learning than me might say, God love you, Wendell. The inerrant word from God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. It never changes. Now, I would answer, yes, you are right. He never changes. But my question is, can we? You know, a funny thing happened this morning is someone like that's not used to doing this, trying to go over and make sure that he's got everything lined up, don't want to miss anything. I was reading over that this morning, and as soon as I finished that, I thought, whoa, wait a minute. Is that what Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians and over in Hebrews? See, we never really talk about that. When he talks about that strange thing about being fed with milk and with solid food. And I thought about it, and when I was explaining that, and I hope you understand me when I say, I've always had a bad problem, and maybe some of y'all can identify with me, reading over it and almost giving it the Evelyn Woods speed reading course. And I'm going to tell you what. Sometimes Christ hides those things. The Spirit hides them for when I'm ready to quit sipping on milk and I want something that sticks to my ribs. For me, these words that I'm going to read and what I just read, I think it's at least ways for me. I believe it answered a question for me. And a little bit of a mystery what Paul might have been talking about. I guess someone said, well, his first cardinal rule of standing up here, after you kind of thanked everyone for the opportunity and get started into it, you should have read a verse of Scripture first. Well, that's what I'm going to talk about right now. This verse of Scripture that I've written these words down came to me back months ago. And I don't know any other way to say it than this. Have you ever had something that just will not go away? It always keeps coming back. Why? Who knows? But before I wrote these words down here, and I want to emphasize that again. All I did was dictate. I mean, dictate or write down, whatever you want to call it. It was a Monday morning. I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago. We had planned to go to work. Had a job to do. But it was one of them real cold mornings. And I'd walked down to the barn to give that old horse a bucket of oats. I was walking back. I thought, doggone, you know what? I don't feel like going over today. So I went back in the kitchen. I think Carol had already left to go to work. At that moment, something told me, Wendell, sit down and get your pen, because it's been a while since you've written anything down. Now, some may say, that sounds all well and good, but it's the truth. Because I wouldn't done this on my own. So that leads me to where we're at right now. I'm gonna read the scripture, because there's just one, and it's out of Luke's gospel. Ain't many words to it. It's going to be Luke chapter 9, verse 24. Everybody there? All right, let's read these words. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. I'm going to tell you, for a long time, I read that, and I thought I knew what he was talking about. And I still may not know what he's talking about. But I feel like I've got a little better understanding. But as something else, as I've got it written down here as we go along, about this passage of Scripture right here. Those same words. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. Now, if I would have had Peggy to earlier in the week, I wanted to put the title of the lesson there and change it. The last one you'd expect. I always, whatever I write down, I always put a title to what I write down. And for me, in these words here that the Spirit of Christ has given me to write down and share with y'all, is my Christian Heisman worth it? Now, that sounds strange. I'll say something about that that title. You know what? When I thought about that, I thought, Lord, should I go for the trifecta? Let's say I got religion, food, football, then from the South, Baptist. I thought, should I go for the trifecta? But joking aside, I'm going to read these words. I am fully convinced and certain you all are wondering, how in the Sam Hill is he going to tie Jesus Christ and the Heisman Trophy together? And I've got to be honest with you, it does sound odd, but I will try. But first, let me say this. These aren't my words, but the words of the Spirit from Christ, our Savior, for mine could never echo or express in the same way. Thanks be to our Lord. I'll begin this way. For a while now, my mind has gone back and forth, trying to figure out a passage of Scripture, Luke 9:24, that I just read. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. Now, I just read from Luke 9:24, but I could have read from any of the other three Gospels. See, it's in all four. Used more than once in two of the Gospels. And here's something here. Did you know no other saying of Jesus is given such emphasis? Out of all the things Christ said and taught, none given more emphasis, which is written down in these Gospels, than that scripture right there. Now, I'm going to tell you what. I don't know about y'all, but that really catches my attention. What does it mean? But I'll bet y'all still wondering how I'm going to tie the Heisman Trophy to this scripture, aren't you? I said earlier, this passage of scripture has been clanking around inside this head of mine for a while. And yes, taking that into account, I will admit and claim on occasions to have a short attention span, so I'm told. But don't a blind hog find an acorn every now and then? All joking and laughing aside, it might be better said that Christ lays an acorn in our path. So don't just step over it. For myself and maybe you, Luke 9:24 is that acorn. The question is, will we hear and accept what it says, or will we continue to stiff arm it? Whoa, Wendell, that sounds mighty blunt. Couldn't you have said it a little less hard and in a little softer way? Maybe so. But remember, we are talking about our lives, aren't we? This is serious. It is from our Lord and Savior, right? He put much emphasis on it. So it has to matter. Just a few words ago, I used the word stiff arm. See, in our world today, I believe it fits. And yes, in our churches today, I believe it fits. I thought about the nation of Israel, how in the Old Testament, they were often described as stiff-necked people. When they write about us sometime in the future, they might say, for the most part, they were good folks. And they'd done a lot of good works. But they always had a tendency to stiff-arm Christ when fear got the best of them. Ouch. I said it. That word fear. I might should have not said it or used it. But I have, and sometimes on certain things have to be said, and this is one of those times. You know what? I'm reminded of an old line in an old song from the 70s. The old rock and roll band. At the very end of the song, it says, there's just a certain amount that's got to come out. Quoting ZZ Top. It seemed right at the time. This word fear is just four little letters. One small word in all our world's vast vocabulary. But oh, how paralyzing it can be when it grabs hold of all of us. I'm not excluding myself. All of us remember as a child when probably our greatest and only fear was the monster that lived under our beds at night. Now here we are years later, all grown up, and fear is still there. Oh, it takes on another disguise, but truthfully, it hasn't left. I would be willing to bet any amount, if I was a betting man, as we sit here today in this room, every one of us in here brought a fear with us today. And sadly, probably carries it with us when we leave it, when we leave. See, it shuns no one. And sadly, in most cases, he's accompanied by his big brother, anger. Fear has many faces. Family related, spouse related, medical, financial, political, cultural, societal. The list goes on and on and on. And truthfully speaking, to let run free, it cripples and fractures. For me, and maybe you, I also believe it always brings out our worst side. Christ deserves more than our bad sides. Here's a question for all. Some of you might already know this. But if I ask the question, what is the opposite of love? How many, real quick, like, would it say hate? But guess what? That would be the wrong answer. The right answer is fear. The opposite of love is fear. There he is again. Tricking us into something and robbing our lives when Christ has promised us so much more. It was important enough to him that he gave his life for the freedom from fear. Going back to the scripture in Luke, when I read these words, lose our life, without a shadow of a doubt in my mind, Christ is saying, lose your fear. You can't keep on stiff-arming me, holding tight, worrying about all the things going on around you, never releasing it, and in the same breath, praising me for all the blessings I send your way. Lord, help us to stop clutching onto our fears. Sometimes we clutch our fear, somehow thinking it will make a difference in the world. Even at times, believing it's legitimate. I could be wrong. For myself, and maybe you also, it won't matter. It might be simple-minded, and some might say these words are simple thinking. Maybe. But what if I'm right? What if losing one's life means losing one's fears? This much I do know. Jesus Christ wants us to live this life in our eternal life, fully devoted to him, not living this life clutching onto our fears. Now to the title of these words I've written down. Is my Christian Heisman worth it? When I sat down to write these words, don't ask me how, but the symbolism of the Heisman Trophy came to me. I don't know why. Maybe it's the visual clutching of the ball and the stiff arm of the player on the trophy. I know it might sound crazy in doing so, using this image and Christ's teaching, but the Spirit from Christ said, use it. It will work. Like a star-studded ball player breaking tackles and stiff-arming his way through the defense, clutching the ball tightly, eyes downfield, determined. For in football, it means winning or losing. You might even get a trophy of recognition for displaying this headstrong attitude and worth ethic. But remember this, it's just a game. Our life, on the other hand, is no game. Isn't it worth much more? Christ said so, right? So why do we treat our fears like some old oblong leather ball filled with air, believing it matters in the game, believing it matters? For in the game of football, it matters how tight you hold the ball. For there, championships are most often decided. But in the game of life, the life Christ promises and talks about, he tells us, stop stiff-arming me. Stop breaking my tackles. Stop running. And just drop the ball. For it's okay. You've played this world's game long enough. I'll tell you the truth. We might not hear the roar of the crowd, but there's not a doubt in my mind that Christ our Lord and all of heaven's cheer will drown out anything we can imagine here. In closing, that old saying coined years ago comes to mind. It's not winning or losing, but how you play the game. And I have to admit, I like this saying. But for this morning, this day, with the words from Luke 9:24 still in my heart and head, Christ could coin another saying, and it might go like this. I don't care about the game you've been playing. Winning isn't everything. Sometimes losing is winning. It's okay. Drop the ball. Drop your fears. In doing so, you found the life. The true life. My unburdened, joy-filled life. Isn't that far better than some old trophy? To Jesus Christ, all glory. Amen. Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father God, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Lord, I thank you for bearing with us as we struggle our way through this life. Lord, doing things sometimes and holding on to things that even when you know they're holding us back, you wait on us sometimes, Lord, till we find it. Lord, I just thank you for bearing with us. As Lord, maybe we do see the light a little bit more. Lord, go with us the rest of the day, the rest of the week, and bring us all back here safe again, Lord. Lord, it's in your merciful name I pray. Amen. You know, I can't see what time it is. There's one last thing I want to share with y'all. And, you know, it's always been said, I don't know when it started, but a picture's worth 1,000 words. And you know what? There is truth in that. Think back when you was a child. Can you remember the words that was said to you? But now a picture. See, that you carry with you your entire life. You know what? Whether it's kind of a corny way, they say, oh, he didn't have to do that. But you know what? I couldn't stand up here without talking about the Heisman Trophy in one time strike the pose. If you'll allow me. I think it goes something like that, don't it? That's all right, isn't it, Lord? No, it's not all right. But Lord, it always makes me feel good when I clutch this ball tight. That's right. I do remember. I remember when you said, "Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, not mine." All my fears this morning. I'm tired of being scared. I'm tired of being frightened.